moist panties.
Okay, yeah, that one is bad. All right,
I hope you've learned your lesson.
That one's bad.
So you're just going from place to place. That's awesome. Mm-hmm. Oh man, get the. Have you ever had gelato?
I have. Oh, you know, when I was in Italy before.
Oh, okay.
Have you had pizza? This episode is made possible by our therapy partners, Dirty B, Pickett, and Jake Schneider. From fabulous Las Vegas, Nevada, this is Pod Therapy. Real people, real problems, and real therapists. You can submit your questions anonymously at podtherapy.net or email us at podtherapyguys@gmail.com. And now, broadcasting from the turn, that's Jim, that's Whitney, I'm Nick. It's time for some Pod Therapy.
Man, look at us. Just a bunch of adventurers trying new things. I'm cooking. Whitney's going to Italy.
Hey, Jim, name a country that borders Italy.
The water. There's
that's true.
There's a lot of it. It's like the Florida of Europe. I know that.
Wow, I'm impressed. Jim even
I know that
has that visual.
What water?
Are you
what water?
Oh,
name the water, Jim.
African
also,
Ocean.
Also,
African
are you ocean. Absolutely sure about Europe?
I mean, yeah, right.
I'm like, just asking.
Or is it? Yeah.
Is it in Europe?
Fuck. It's also Africa. Like, so maybe it's both. Is it more Africa than it is Europe?
Well, we don't
maybe
know
it's
what,
both.
We don't know what side of Italy she's going to. If she's
I
going to the Africa side.
That's true.
Yeah.
Or if she's going to the Asia
yeah,
side.
Yeah, probably matters which side you're. Oh, there's an Asia side. Okay.
Yeah.
I didn't know
about
that. I only know what I know about Italy from World War II documentaries.
Uh-huh.
And I remember there being like, oh.
Okay. Ally or Axis.
They were bad guys. I remember that.
That doesn't answer the question.
I feel like it did. I feel like it's. I'm in the right ballpark.
Just say you don't know and we'll move on.
Yeah, I don't know. But I remember they were bad guys. But I remember like the good guys went to like Africa and fought somebody with tanks or something. I don't know. Norman? Does that feel right? Is there a guy named Norman?
Norman.
You talking about Schwarzkopf? Normandy.
Yeah.
Are you talking about Storm and Norman Schwarzkopf?
Nah, I don't know. Maybe it was the Normandy thing. That's not in Africa, is it?
Oh my gosh. Funny.
No, it is not.
Funny geography. Back at like Peter's childhood home he grew up in, there's a globe that exists there that has Soviet Socialist Republic listed.
Oh, nice.
Yes.
Oh, USSR?
Yeah.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah.
My
that's
little nieces
keepsake,
were
man.
Like, what?
The fuck is USSR?
Like, all right, don't learn anything from this.
Yeah,
you're
yeah,
good.
Yeah. This is not where we go to learn
So
things.
Laura and I went downtown. We went down to the Arts District this morning.
Ooh.
And, aww. Just kind of hang out. And so there's a couple antique stores down mm-hmm. there.
Yeah.
I love, which is so weird because like when I was younger, when I was a kid, going into an antique shop was just like, oh my God, this
old
is so
dusty shit.
Absolutely.
And now
worst.
Like, I love it.
You get it.
And so anytime I come across an old globe,
mm-hmm.
that's the first thing as I do. I flip over to Europe and I like see,
yeah.
Do we have Czechoslovakia?
Yeah.
Yugoslavia.
That was one that, yeah, was not yep. right.
I like that. Yeah. First thing
oh
is to make
gosh.
Sure how current it is.
Yeah.
Anyway, adventures galore, exciting times. Are you bringing us back souvenirs from Italy? Because I would like some gelato.
Okay.
Limone flavor.
Okay.
Yes, please. Please bring him back some gelato.
Yes. I
can't
would like
wait.
That. Yeah. Yeah. That would be my move.
Send a little baggy.
You know what?
That's all I was thinking. Yeah. Baggy.
A little bit of milk.
Yeah,
bring
yeah.
him back some milk.
Some lemon flavored milk.
That is exactly what that gelato will be. Lemon flavored milk.
Welcome to Pod Therapy. Glad to have you. If you'd like to join the pre-party, come check us out. Patreon.com/therapy. You can get this whole show ad-free and extended and learn more about us as people, which is helpful whenever we try to answer these questions. The more you know about us, the more our answers hopefully make some version of sense. But we've got some great questions for today's show, and we're leading off with Crying Wolf in Mental Health. And it says, I have to remain anonymous as I work for a corporation and don't want to lose my job. I have a coworker who started here as the pandemic was lifting in the summer of 2021. She was in her early 30s and had experience, so I was excited to have her as my backup assistant.
She was a wolf.
And she cried.
Crying. Yeah.
She was smart, and I felt I could rely on her. The first couple of years, she would bring up events that she said affected her mental health. I'm all for people feeling comfortable at work and having good mental health, and so I stood up for her. I noticed that I was getting looks from other colleagues for standing up for her, but I just brushed it off that they are older and they don't understand. After a couple of years, I did start to notice that when she did not get her way or had to do more than one task at a time, she would throw around her mental health and management would do whatever they needed to do to prevent a situation. She is at the point now that management is afraid of their own shadow, and she now runs the office with her accusations. How do I deal with an assistant? Did I mention my assistant just retired this week? That I can't ask her to do anything as it affects her mental health. I would appreciate your thoughts. A fan of the show and Jim's Geography Anonymous.
You got to burn down the office.
Yeah, I think there's only one room.
I was going to say, can she stay the assistant? You just hire a new or stay the just,
yeah,
backup
the other assistant,
backup.
Yeah.
I mean, honestly, the easiest thing is for you to quit your job.
That's probably yeah, the
it's like somebody yeah. else's problem. But
yeah,
assuming that's not going to be an option,
promote her to your boss.
Right? Is there a way that you can just give her early retirement?
I want you to take a portion of my salary and go home.
Yeah,
it's be easier.
This is a tough one.
It is.
Oh man.
Because I think, although I think we've made great strides in being open and accepting of mental health, and you know, being able to talk openly about it and accepting it when, you know, taking good care of ourselves. There are people out there that yeah. have seen this and are like, oh, you know, I can kind of take advantage of this.
Right.
And maybe she's not taking advantage of it intentionally.
Yeah.
Right.
But it is one of those things where it's, I don't know.
She has found the path of least resistance
yeah.
and
yeah.
is taking that path.
Yeah.
Yeah.
yeah. Yeah, because I mean, we want people to be comfortable, and we want to try to accommodate as much as we can, but there's still some lifting that has to be done on the other end of that as well.
Right.
Like, the world is not going to just completely, like, bow to your wishes.
Right.
At some point, there are going to be some times where it's like, I realize that you're having a tough day today, we want to accommodate as best we can. However, this stuff still has to get done.
Yeah. Right.
There are still obligations that we still need to meet.
And if you're not able to do those things, there are programs for those people. There are mm-hmm. disability programs and things like that that mm-hmm. exist. If you are not able to function in a standard work environment, then maybe that's what you need to go do.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe yeah. you need to look into that.
Yeah.
I do definitely give people the benefit of the doubt in the sense that, like, I never... My first assumption, or I try for it not to be my first assumption, is that someone's taking advantage of a situation.
Right.
I always try to err on the side of, okay, they're not doing this intentionally. This is kind of, you know, and try to show a little bit of empathy. It's just like, this is what they're dealing with right now.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But obviously there are limits to all that.
Yeah. Well, and I heard Ryder, you say at the end that you can't ask her to do anything as it affects her mental health. You can still ask, like, right. it's her job mm-hmm. to be the assistant, then mm-hmm. you're going to be asking her. And I feel like that will naturally bring up, like, a pattern over time. Like, right. hey, I've asked you to do these 10 things and you were only able to do 2.
Right.
What's going on? It, like, allows right. conversations Ooh. To be revisited.
Oh, I think I've got a good conversation starter here.
Okay.
You said that your current assistant is retiring.
And she's the backup assistant.
And she is currently the backup assistant.
Yeah.
So presumably she's going to at least apply for the full-time position.
Sure.
Yeah.
Or gets it.
Or yeah. or just be given it or whatever. I would suggest having, if not an application process, if your intention is to just give her the job, then don't worry about having a full application process, but perhaps a meeting.
Oh, this is a good idea.
Where it is simply about, here are the responsibilities of this person. Here is the day-to-day duties of this position. Is this something that you think you can handle?
Like,
it's like
that.
A refresh.
That's it.
Yeah.
You would be required to do this,
Ooh,
this,
like
this,
that.
And this every day.
Yeah.
You know, after lunch, you'd be required to do these things. Like, this is the requirement of the position.
Right.
Are you able to fulfill these requirements on a daily basis?
I really like the idea of defined job tasks,
yeah.
which can be really tricky because a lot of roles, they're not. You know?
It's going to be a little flexible sometimes.
Right.
But you can write that in. You can write that into a job
that's
description.
That's huge, because then you have this, like, informed consent situation
right.
where it's like, hey, this is what this job is. if you can't do this job, I totally understand. Nobody wants to hurt your mental health.
That's it.
Nobody wants to harm you.
And not every job is for every person.
Mm-hmm. But please don't step into that role if that's not something you can do. Because if you step into that role, but you can't fulfill that role, we fundamentally have to go hire a second person. And now we have to pay two people to do a job that we've budgeted one person to do.
Yeah.
I love the idea of defining it if you can.
Yeah.
That's a great way to sort of.
And it also gives you a time to define kind of what your responsibilities to that assistant are going to be.
Right.
You know, it's going to be, you know, there are going to be times that I'm going to hand you a project and I'm going to need that project back, you know, in a 2-hour time period.
Right.
But I'll give you that time period. I'll tell you what that time period is going to be. Sometimes it's going to be a bit of a time crunch. Sometimes it'll be a more of a loosey-goosey situation. But that allows you to kind of give that person, you know, here's the kind of heads up that I'm going to give you. Here's what I'm going to expect from you. And in change, here is what you can expect from me.
I like that.
This is a much easier problem to deal with if we're talking about the person being promoted into a new role.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's really difficult if we're talking about them functioning in the role that they already have.
We already try to give her things to do, and she has basically like slimmed down her responsibilities because administration is scared. And that opens up that larger, you know, conversation about like, we are all, I think, happy that mental health has become prominent. It's something that the world talks about now. We like that it's not as taboo. Mm-hmm. This is all really good. But then there is a lot of misunderstanding about it. And as people become sensitive to it and organizations become sensitive to it, and they don't want to be accused of being, you know, negligent, they don't want to be liable for any harm, and they certainly want their employees to be okay, it does create this space. And I don't know, Whitney, if you've seen a lot of this, but like coming through the COVID era, I was getting so many FMLA requests and like people like trying to like seek short-term disability or even if they weren't trying to cash, you know, like their short-term disability insurance or anything like that, looking for special accommodations from their employer, especially if they had really big employers, like they worked for a bank or, you know, big institutions, they would constantly be like, hey, I want you to provide documentation that basically says I have anxiety or whatever. And they were getting all sorts of reduction in hours without reduction of pay, changes in their responsibilities, all sorts of extra breaks. And like
working from home.
Right. Yeah. Working from home. And, you know, it was tricky because like on my side of the street, I want to align myself with that person. They're my patient. I do care about them.
Yeah.
And I'm not here to tell them whether or not they're, you know, skimping on the job or what do I care? Like big fucking corporation is not my responsibility. This human is.
Right.
But there were definitely times that I'm like, I feel like you're kind of weaponizing this and you're just like using me and like the power of mental health as an institution to sort of push against the larger corporation. And I always felt like a weird like juxtaposition of that because part of me is kind of like, well, as an American, you don't have any other options.
Yeah.
You don't have a union. You don't have anything else that would push back and get you some kind of reprieve and get treated better. So you have to use the fear of this liability. So that's not really your fault. Mm-hmm. But then it does come into this cry wolf thing of like mental health being used all the fucking time.
Yeah.
And it opens up an interesting conversation of like, does that water down the conversation we need to be having? Does that misrepresent what mental health is to your coworkers? Is that okay? Like, what are some of your views on that?
Yeah, I was getting flashbacks to emotional support animal letters when you mentioned that, where it's like, oh, I want this. You're like,
My gerbil needs to come with me to Sam's Club.
Yeah. But anyway, as far as like mental health being kind of weaponized in some ways, it's a challenge because I think people learning about their own mental health, I think a lot of them are kind of going back to what Nick was saying, they aren't even maybe consciously doing that. They're just like, this is uncomfortable. I'm trying to feel out,
not trying to be dishonest,
you know, how uncomfortable I am at this job or when something's requested. Now I'm overwhelmed.
Yes.
And in some
conflating discomfort with a symptom, right? Because they're like, no. I had a patient for a long time that would say PTSD, and they'd say, oh man, I was really struggling at work, my PTSD started acting up. And it would put me in a weird position where I need to educate them that that's not what PTSD is.
Uh-huh.
Like, PTSD is not stress.
Uh-huh.
But they're like, no, what is this? It's a stress disorder. And like, Like, but I also want to be really careful, yeah. right? Because I don't want to minimize this or diminish yeah. it, because you need to feel advocated for.
Yeah.
And at the same time, you want to kind of minimize it and diminish it.
Yeah, I want to right size it a little bit, because like, they're throwing
feel like it needs
around.
To be minimized a little bit. Like,
you're triggering my down. PTSD at work, and like the boss is like, oh no, I'm so sorry. Like, yeah, don't ask me to do things. And like, I'm just going to go for a smoke break. And they're like, can you believe it, Jim? They asked me to do 3 things today. And I'm like, I don't know what to do.
Yeah.
Like, well, yeah. Your boss,
seems reasonable.
That does seem reasonable.
And I think it's kind of a delicate balance, because my initial response is kind of like we've talked about with ADHD in the past, where right. the symptoms are very real and can be very disruptive to your life. But at some point,
yeah.
you need to take charge of those symptoms and do the best you can to seek help, seek
right.
Or apply certain behaviors, you know. Do the best you can with what you're given and take some like accountability for that.
Yeah.
And
not
then
the world's job to adapt.
Right. Yeah. Basically. But yeah, I think that it's wonderful that this person can tell their boss, you know, hey, I'm struggling with this, you know, this issue, or whenever there's extra work piled on, I'm very overwhelmed and I can't do it. But yeah, at some point you have to decide, like, is this job right for me? Kind of going back to what Jacob said, and when there's not a clear end point,
yeah.
you know, or starting of a new point, I think I was going to say not all companies might do this, but we were joking about this earlier. There are annual evaluations
yeah,
or quarterly evaluations that I remember working in corporate world. And it's like, did you do all of your tasks that were required of you?
Right.
Scale yourself. I'm going to scale you. We're going to talk about it. And if you aren't, we're going to start a, I think they call them PIPs or something, like a
yeah.
performance improvement plan.
Yeah, there
yeah.
we go.
Yeah.
So then it gives room to say not only what we can do to accommodate you, but like, what do you need also from us? Do you need us to give you a certain amount of warning, or do you
right.
need us to put a limit on how much we're able to give you at a time? And you know what, if we're only allowed to give you 3 tasks at a time instead of 10, we might have to adjust your pay for that, because we are going to have to hire someone else. Like
right.
kind of like natural consequences there. And then the person can decide, do I want to stay at this job? Is
right.
this the right job for me? And where I say that should be treated delicately is because not everybody can just leave their job or change jobs to something easier. Maybe they are doing their best and
yeah.
they need to feed themselves, their families.
Oof,
you know,
it gets tricky, especially with
yeah.
the American with Disabilities Act and
oh,
like
yeah.
some sort of protections that are like, hey, are
yeah.
we discriminating against somebody with a health crisis?
Right. I think for me, like as a manager, how I would deal with this situation is separate the tasks from the methods.
Okay.
The task has to get done.
Mm-hmm.
So if we're accommodating for someone's special needs,
mm-hmm.
we're not accommodating the task. The task
right.
is the job that needs to get done.
Mm-hmm.
We accommodate the methods in which you do the job.
Yeah.
Right.
So in the
you
same
gotta sort,
sense,
these widgets need to be sorted.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So do you need an hour of extra time to sort the widgets?
Mm-hmm.
Do you need a different environment in which you can sort the widgets?
Right.
Do you need X, Y, and Z to sort the widgets? But at the
right.
end of the day, the widgets are getting sorted.
Whereas it sounds like
yeah.
writer
say,
situation.
Say sort the widgets again.
Sort
yeah.
the widgets.
Yeah.
Sounds like
emphasis
a writer
on the
situation.
Yeah.
This,
sort
the person
the
is like not sorting the widgets anymore.
Yeah.
And corporation is like, hey,
and
don't
think,
ask her to sort the widgets. We don't want to upset her.
Yeah, and I think that's kind of where we need to maybe draw the line. It's like,
yeah.
well, okay, then we need to look at somebody else for this job.
Right.
And, you know, it's kind of like, you know, when... I don't know if you're aware of this, but in Nevada, if you're going to take your test for the your drug and alcohol license,
mm-hmm.
you can request accommodations for extra time.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But the test doesn't change.
Right.
You're answering the same questions. You have to present the same case study. You have to do all of these things.
Mm-hmm. Right.
The task is the same. The method is slightly modified.
Right.
And that's kind of what I'm talking about. You know,
it's
like
a good example. Yeah.
Yeah. If we can, if the tasks can't get done, then it's just, that's just the person can't perform that job. We need to find something
right.
else for them to do.
So if you're in a situation where this is a coworker or even a direct report, you don't have the ability to govern their job. HR has already told you, like, hey, don't mess with this person. We're scared of this person. We are a big corporation. they answer to you or assist you, but you should think of them more as a coworker, not as somebody that like you can decide their job description or something like that. I get the impression that writers is somewhat powerless and like is sort of looking at this and saying, ugh, you know, I obviously listen to this podcast. I support mental health. I want to believe in this human. How do I, as an individual, interact with people in my life who are doing this? And I think that's an open question that's beyond even workplace. Like whenever you have friends, we've had people write in about this kind of thing before where they've done that in groups of friends. They've like always like thrown their hands in the air and like, oh me, oh my, you know, I'm just going through so much. And people are like, oh shit, okay, we need to like make you the highest priority. And we've had people say in the past, like, I think I have a friend who's kind of crying wolf here.
Yeah.
I don't want to be insensitive, but like, how do I deal with that? This, I think, is kind of bordering that same open question. Is I don't think writer has the ability to do any of the things that we're suggesting so far. I feel like those are corporate things that maybe writer doesn't have those levers.
And if that's the case, then I mean, then it's a conversation between you and HR.
Fair. Yeah,
then it is like, hey, this person, my understanding of what of this person's job description is X, Y, and Z.
Yeah.
Right.
Is that correct?
Right.
Do I need to redefine my expectations
right.
of what this person is here being paid to do?
Right.
Explain to me what this person's job. If I'm going to supervise this person, I need to understand this person's job description.
Right.
And so HR, please help me understand what this person's job description is.
In writing.
Is. Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, tell me what I'm allowed to ask and what the expectations are.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like that.
And then if you have additional needs, then you can go back to HR. You can go to your superior, whatever it is.
I like that.
And say, you know, here's what my expectation was of this assistant position.
Yes.
Now I'm now being told these are not reasonable expectations. I'm being told by HR that these are not the expectations that they understand, and these are not the expectations that are put upon that person.
Right.
How
does this get done?
Now I need an additional person.
Right.
I need help with this.
I need to know how this gets
done. And so, I mean, if it is somebody else's problem to deal with,
make it.
It's sometimes difficult to just say, like, hey, you have to solve this then.
Right.
Like, here's an issue. If I can't solve it, that means you have to solve it, boss.
Yeah.
Well, what I find in corporate settings is that there has to be a problem before there's solving. Yeah. You can't go in and be like, I've been asking and you know, I'm not getting some of these things done. I would like extra help. And they're like, you would like extra help or do you need it?
Right.
And it's not until your work is not getting done because your assistant isn't doing stuff. Like, I tend to appreciate the natural progression of things in general in life. So if I'm the writer, I'm gonna be asking her to do stuff, and if she pushes back, that's all documented.
Document everything. Every
that's an email.
Just email everything.
But I think you're both right. I don't think that the system wants to try to fix anything. If you're predicting what will go wrong, I think you have to allow things. Like, you have to let the eggs hit the ground.
Yeah. Right.
But the obvious answer that we've all neglected here is to out mental health crisis this woman.
Ooh.
And just play chicken with it and be like, her mental health is affecting my mental health. Yeah. Like,
it's making my PTSD act up.
Right. You're getting all my PTSDs going because I'm so stressed.
Tell the assistant, no, I am just so stressed. I need you to help me.
I need you to solve these problems. Well, I can't solve these problems because it triggers me. Oh my God, I'm being triggered by you being triggered.
Yeah.
This camera, just keep going.
I need
going.
My assistant.
Yeah, that's right. And then be the first one to run to HR and just be like, I can't keep doing this. I'm really overwhelmed and blah, blah, blah. And
that's the obvious answer.
Yeah, I think that's the move.
Also, you're going to want to go to the Pod Therapy Bait and Tackle Shop.
Yes.
And buy the shirt that says PTSD's Nuts.
Yeah.
I'll print that up right now.
Yeah. Just putting that in the shop as we speak. PTSD, these nuts.
Actually, that might be a good logo for PTSD's the shirt where your nuts are already on Jim's head in the basketball game.
Yeah, I haven't seen that one.
Might be a good caption for that one.
Well, writer, this is a tough one. And, you know, I think that we've definitely seen this in the world, and it's so tricky because ultimately it's like we talked about in the past, and I think Whitney brought this up is really true. That, anybody that's out there, you cannot expect the world to bend to you. But at the same time, I do feel like I resonate with the American workforce who often feels like there is no excuse. There is no accommodation. Yeah. They are cattle. Yeah. And then you talk to a friend in France or a different country and they're like, oh, your health is not a priority. You're not, you've reported that you're not able to get things done. And they just said, oh, fucking well, we'll find somebody who will. That's illegal. And we're like, no, it's absolutely not illegal.
Not in most states.
That is not how that shit works. So I resonate. And unfortunately, I think because of like the symptoms of the society, a lot of times mental health is used now as a release valve to like get fair treatment or some kind of relief. And then it becomes a difficult thing when we're all rowing at one speed in one direction and one person pulls their oar out of the water. Mm-hmm. And we're like, what are we supposed to do? And like, oh, you have to don't acknowledge that she has a mental health thing. And it's like, okay, like I want to be sensitive, but at some point I need that person, or I need that person to get the fuck out of the boat because the rest of us need to get this done.
Yeah.
And that's just such a tricky
thing. Yeah. I like what Nick said too, though. Like, that's kind of reaching out to her and saying, what do you need? Like, the task is here. Is there a different way to approach this? And maybe they just haven't asked her and she only feels like she can share, like, I can't do it. And I haven't built rapport enough with somebody to tell them more details.
Yeah. I think sometimes too, it's like sometimes, I don't know, like in management positions, I can speak for myself in this case where like I have a task that I need this person to do and I have a way that I want them to do it. And if their methods don't match with how I want it done, then sometimes they'll still do it my way and they'll still struggle.
Yeah.
Like, and I think a good manager sometimes kind of goes to the person's like, okay, we both understand what needs to be done. Here's how I would do it. But do you have a different method?
Right.
I don't care how it gets done.
Talk to a client about this. Yeah. Yes. She like struggles with high anxiety. And I was trying to suggest to her, you know, like, have you thought about talking to your supervisor and sharing with them how you would prefer for them to give, they're giving the same feedback. Mm-hmm. She's not like, oh, don't give me feedback. She's like, I'm okay hearing the same thing, but just instead of throughout the day, could it just be like at the end? Because throughout the day, it like builds the anxiety, right?
Oh, yeah.
So like, in my opinion, I did tell her, I was like, they may not change. They may say, nope, that's just how I have to do it. And that's fine.
Right.
But it's okay to share with managers, you know, this is what would be helpful for me. And most good managers will want to hear like, oh, okay, you're not saying don't tell me what I'm doing wrong. You're just saying, hey, instead of every 5 minutes, could we maybe like have a lunch break or you know, halfway through the day or the end of the day, can you let me know like how I can improve or whatever? And so, yeah, they were struggling with sharing that because they're like, well, I don't feel like I know them. Well, you know, there's not rapport built. I was like, that's really interesting. Like, I don't know. A lot of dynamics go into play in this mental health.
It is a tough thing. Like, I mean, and writer, I appreciate that you're, you know, I definitely do not read you as a bad guy. I read you as somebody saying, hey, look,
help.
I believe in this. I'm trying to be an advocate. Shit still has to get done. This is the real world. And like, you know, this person doesn't work directly. It's not my business. It's a larger business. So like at the end of the day, we're both just getting paid to do this. So like I'm working for them and with them, like, you know, I'm on team, you know, coworkers. But at the same time, like if this person fails me, now I look bad and I'm not hitting my performance goals. And that can't be okay because I can't tell my boss, a member of my team that I rely on, has a mental health condition and you need to be sensitive to my failures.
Yeah.
It won't fucking work.
Right.
You know? And so again, like that just puts you in such a weird position. I really would encourage you. All these are really good suggestions. Documentation like crazy, going to HR for a very clear understanding of what are the expectations? How do we get this done? Like, what are the accommodations? And then going to that person, I really love that idea and having a direct conversation that's like on the level and like, so are you taking over these responsibilities? Is it not your desire to do that? Do you want to make sure we keep you exactly in the lane that you are? And therefore, there's going to be a new requisition order and we're going to open up a position for somebody else. Is it your intention to take that position? Are you fully aware of what that position requires? Because we may not be able to afford you the same accommodations you've had as an assistant, you know, or backup or whatever. So I like all that, you know, and like using the system to your advantage. And then definitely playing escalation chicken on the mental health. I mean, just keep reaching for higher disorders until, like,
we have crying wolf, we have playing chicken. Yeah. What else can we include here?
Yeah, just throw it as high as you can and just be like, you know what? I can't do this anymore. Like,
develop new personalities. Yes. One is an actual wolf.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, that's so great. Shit on the HR desk.
It's a furry. Like, you know.
Sir, you can't do this. Excuse me? Excuse me.
This is how I cope.
PTSD.
This is how I cope.
Newest shirt. Go to podtherapybaitshop.com. I'm pretty sure that link still works. We don't own it. So I don't know where it points. I hope it points to a store. We're going to take a quick break. And when we come back, we're going to talk about pesky questions about pregnancy.
Hmm.
You're listening to Pod Therapy.
Today's episode is brought to you by Benton's on Malia, Richard Macy, Sonny Boy, Thunder Cougar, Cougar, Falcon, Scoop, Slurry Kaye, Motherfucker, Sandra McWaffle, and Alina. And if you would like to sponsor the show, become a therapy producer at patreon.com/therapy. All right. Trivia this week. Let's go back to our host's interests.
Yeah.
If a golfer celebrates a hole-in-one by sipping bourbon at the 19th hole, then goes home to find his water shutoff valve leaking, what is the best course of action? Uses golf clubs to tighten the valve.
Uh-huh.
Call the plumber before the house becomes a water hazard. Uh-huh. Ignore it and hope it fixes itself. Try to fix it after another glass of bourbon.
Oh, man. None of those sound like the right answer. I'm going to take the best available, which is probably fixing it with your golf clubs. That's not how I think you should, but it's the only one that seems like you're doing something right fucking now, and that's probably a good choice.
Call the plumber.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay. Yeah. You call the plumber. You don't hit it with a golf club.
Your house is destroyed by the time that plumber gets there.
No, honestly, what you have to do is you have to know where, because you have to have the, you have to know where the water shutoff valve in the house is.
Yes.
And you have to know where the street water shutoff valve for the whole property is.
Yes.
Because then you got to be able to shut off the whole property.
Mm-hmm.
Mine has just the one. I have one that shuts off.
You've got one.
You've got on the street,
because you
got
one.
Too.
You have one in your garage.
Yes,
that's the one that you know of.
That's main water.
There's one underground in front of your house, like at the street.
You need the second one.
The other one's for the water company.
Yeah. Okay,
but it has a valve in there as well.
Okay,
that's the main. That's where the main, like, meter and everything.
Oh.
Where they're metering how much water you're using, so they know how much to charge you.
There's a water leak between A and B.
Then you can shut off that main.
That's when you go to the A and you shut that one off. But B is usually going to protect your house.
Right.
Okay, got it.
What is the term for a microphone that is designed to pick up sound from only one direction?
Oh, shit.
Often used to reduce background noise in podcasting.
Give us the answers.
Omnidirectional microphone.
No.
Bidirectional microphone.
Ooh, that's sexy.
Cardioid microphone.
That sounds right.
Hypercardioid microphone.
I'm going to go cardioid microphone.
I'm doing hypercardioid microphone.
Oh, you're
doing
a little bit extra on that. I like
doing
that.
Doing the extra. The D.
Probably.
The D.
What?
Whitney's bringing the D. You heard her.
She wants all the D.
I'm going to go C.
Dang it.
It should be hyper. It should be D. It's usually called supercardioid, but hypercardioid, I guess, is just a different term for it.
Boy, Jacob's gotten both of
what
the microphone answers.
Dumbass.
Yeah?
He doesn't know anything.
No, it should be supercardioid.
Nope.
But they might have just made up the term hypercardioid.
Nope. Oh.
The intern knows everything.
No, I'm saying they may have made up the term hyper.
But it's super?
Yeah.
Supercardioid.
You have cardioid and supercardioid.
No points. Give Jim all the points. This feels right.
What U.S. state is home to the only royal palace in the United States? Oh, I know this one.
What the fuck?
Gotta be Hawaii.
It is Hawaii.
What?
Yeah.
What? There's a royal palace in Hawaii?
Yeah.
Why, Jim? Why is there a royal?
Fucking I don't know.
Oh,
why the fuck would that be there? The
Jim.
Queen lives there?
Yeah, you're on the right
is
track.
Is it like a summer
you're
house
close.
For the queen or something?
Okay, not the queen you're thinking of, but that's okay.
What?
You're
one
thinking,
queen?
You're thinking
well,
two,
she's
well,
dead.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're thinking
and
too
so
white.
So there's no queen.
Yeah. What the fuck?
Yeah.
Way
your
too pale.
Too
way too pale.
Yeah, yeah.
Like Queen Latifah?
Oh.
Weirdly closer.
We're just reeling them in to stick all the bait. Yeah.
So it's not like a real building. It's like Queen Latifah's
no,
estate.
No,
no.
It's a royal
it's
palace.
It's a real queen.
The royals that ruled Hawaii before the U.S.
It was the kingdom
took over
of Hawaii.
Yeah.
Before we annexed it.
Yeah.
Huh.
Yeah, look at that.
I thought they had a chief.
Oh, my. Sexist.
Sexist. Have you not seen Moana?
I have. I love Moana.
All right. Then you get it.
They weren't in Hawaii. They were in like Fiji
or somewhere.
They
were kind of Hawaii.
No, that's so far.
Okay, one more for this one. What knot commonly taught in scouting is known for its strength and ease of untying even after being tightened under a load?
I'm sure I learned this at I'm so bad camping at with sex offenders.
Yeah. Camp sex offender?
I think they've changed the name of that now.
I think they have.
Square knot. Clove hitch, bow line, or sheet bend?
I'll go with clove hitch.
Yeah, I want clove hitch.
Oh, I'm going to go with whatever Jacob says.
That's a
solid
move.
I'm
going to
go with that.
Yeah. Cardioid.
After the square knot, the bow line was the most commonly taught, so I'm going to go with bow line.
Okay.
But it might be clove hitch.
Yeah. I think the ease of release makes me go clove hitch more than bow line.
Clove hitch was my nickname in high school.
Whitney?
Oh, I was just going to do... Actually, my original guess was going to be that, but now I'm just going to go with whatever Jacob said.
So we're all going clove hitch then.
Yeah. Except me. I went with bowline.
Yeah, that was what I was going to say.
And it's bowline.
Oh, there you go.
Should have gone with my gut.
So
the clove hitch is going to be easier.
Fuck you.
But the clove hitch is going to be easier to disengage even after it's been under load than the bowline.
I feel like we have some thoughts. I think we have some notes on this
This
system.
Intern, who is this?
You know, Emma is just fucking around. I don't know how I feel about this.
You fixed the water line with the golf club. Settle down.
I was in the right ballpark. Look, I was the only one taking it seriously.
Save it for the six-month review.
You call a plumber in Las Vegas, and your home is gone by the time they get there.
Like, yeah, turn the water off.
Yes, but that was the option I went with. It involved using a golf club. Why the fuck not? Use the putter. I don't know. Is that all the questions?
Yep.
All right, I'm in the lead. Pesky questions about pregnancy from Anonymous. Hey, everyone. I'm desperately seeking advice on more creative ways to say, mind your own business and leave me the fuck alone. Backstory. Grab some popcorn. My husband and I are a pretty traditional, suburban, Midwestern, professional couple. I get it. There are societal norms, and we've mostly stuck to them. Bought a house about 2 years ago in a nice neighborhood, got married last October, and have been laser-focused on our careers since. I juggle two jobs, a doctoral program, and all the horse stuff. Yes, actual horses.
Cool.
Horse stuff can also be many jobs. Well, my husband just switched jobs about a month ago to tackle higher-level cases. We totally understand that life happens and the best-laid plans often go awry. But based on multiple factors, my husband and I have crafted what we think is a pretty solid master plan for the next few years. Houses, careers, kids, dogs, you name it, we've scheduled it. So everything can flow as harmoniously as possible. But wait, as soon as we said, I do, the barrage began. When are you going to have kids? Are you pregnant yet? Lovely. Those were mildly irritating, but I'd usually respond with something like, nope, I want to finish my doctorate. And the conversation would thankfully move on. Since then, the comments have escalated dramatically. Lately, I've been getting gems like, well, you never know how long trying will take. Better to start sooner rather than later. You can still do a doctorate and be pregnant. Oh, but my personal favorites include, you won't even need that degree once you have kids.
Oh my God.
Woo! You can always finish it later if you even still want to do it.
In fairness, that part is true. Jim had kids and then started gambling his doctorate.
This is true. Yeah. I need to win one back or go back to school.
Yeah.
And then another one. But if you wait until then, it will be considered a geriatric pregnancy.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And just when I thought it couldn't get any worse, we started house shopping to take our time finding the perfect place and get settled before having kids. We love our current house, but we knew it wasn't our forever home. After 2 years, we've noticed it's not exactly kid-friendly. Now, nearly every time someone hears we're house hunting, they launch into what feels like an interrogation. What's wrong with your house? Why would you move out of such a beautiful home? They proceed to tell us how they had it worse and made do. How lucky we are to have the house we have, especially at our age, and inevitably toss in, but you've only been there 2 years. Sigh. Why does anyone care or feel the need to shower us with their unsolicited opinions? I know these are well-meaning people, but it's getting to the point where I'm starting to avoid social situations and generally changing my behavior to dodge these interactions. This is coming from friends, both my husband's and mine, colleagues or their spouses, bosses, classmates, family, and even random humans who happen to know anything about us. I cannot bring myself to be an asshole and tell them to mind their own business and fuck off. I'm fresh.
Oh, I got to come up with a different answer.
And there goes, Jacob's crumpling paper in the
back. Start thinking.
Yeah. I'm fresh out of ideas on how to respond, especially as the comments keep leveling up. I understand that it's my family, my body, my money, and my life, but it seems like these are socially acceptable things for people to say to me, and I'm at a loss for new creative ways to tactfully address this. Since I can't change other people or the questionable social norms, no matter how stupid they are, what would you all recommend? Can't wait to hear your takes, ideas, and opinions on this. Thanks a million, everyone. Anonymous pronouns are she and her.
I think the obvious one is to just make it more uncomfortable for the person who's asked the question.
Say something weird.
Yeah, well, like, how so? I mean, give me an example.
So, why aren't you having kids yet? And just be like,
I love it.
So
in
the butt.
The
angle of my uterus, and you know what? Forget it. I'll just show you
my vaginal lining.
why are you getting a house already? Yeah. You've only been there 2 years. Well, it's the angle of my uterus. You know what? Forget it. I'll just show you.
He can only climax with butt stuff.
Yeah.
We're never going to conceive. It's driving me crazy.
I like the practice of just start scream crying and run from the room.
And then they're like, oh my God, I'm so sorry.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm so sorry, what did I do?
They will never mention it again.
Even better.
If you can like snot on command, if you start doing that crying where the snot starts running out of your nose. That's really
what if
ideal.
You just like didn't answer. I'm just laughing at the idea. You just change the subject or totally walk off. Like, would they just keep asking? Like again? Like how many times would they ask? You know. I feel like this happens more. I was thinking on this because I feel, in one hand, really lucky. Not many, if hardly any, of our like family or close friends have really pushed, asked anything like that, mm-hmm. and I feel like that's an outlier. However, I do feel like the closer I get to 40, the more people do really ask and question and push, especially mm-hmm. the kids thing. And I was sitting here thinking the people that do that the most tend to be either from the Midwest or the South.
Yeah.
Like even if they live in Vegas now.
Yeah.
I was like, okay. Like people from Vegas or the West Coast, whatever, like other countries, they don't ask that.
No.
Well, I mean, I think I was probably, I was well into college, maybe even, I was probably in my master's degree before I even had that realization like, oh, I don't have to have kids.
Mm.
Interesting.
Yeah, like
I
it was
hear
just,
that before, like you just thought you would, like,
yeah,
because everyone
just like,
has
well,
kids.
Well, that's what you do.
Yeah.
You know, and the thought of not having kids seriously had never occurred to me until I was like well into my master's program.
Oh man, that happened with Jesus for me. I was like, had a whole breakdown. I was like, I never thought he just might not exist. It was a moment. Oh, the South. But yeah, I think that I wanted to ask you, did people ever, like as men, Jacob and Nick?
Yes.
Thanks for nodding at me, but not acknowledging. It's fine.
Men who do not have kids.
Just sit here.
Did people ever push you all? Like,
oh yeah,
I was gonna,
about kids.
Yeah,
about kids.
Oh, I don't
yeah.
think I ever.
No one ever asked
No one in my family, like my mother, my dad, my sister, aunts, uncles. None of
your
them,
sister didn't even.
No, hadn't? None of them have ever asked about whether or not I was going to have kids.
Wow.
My parents asked, but pretty normally and like, I would say respectfully.
Like, have you, like curiosity,
like years
like
and years
pressure.
Ago, they both just kind of were like, hey, is this something you guys have think about? And the answer was no. And then that's just, that's held since then.
Yeah.
My mother-in-law is a different story. My mother-in-law would really like her daughter to have a baby.
Oh, okay. This still? She still comes up?
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
It doesn't come up all the time anymore, but it still comes up. It comes up a few times a year.
Yeah. How is that best
and it's
handled?
Pretty, it's pretty mild.
Not too pushy.
No.
So it's just, hey, have you changed your mind on this? No, we haven't. All right.
It's not even a question.
Okay.
Now, it's like, it sure would be great if you guys had a kid.
Passive little comments.
Yeah, yeah.
That it sounds like y'all tolerate.
Yeah, and we say something along the lines of, nope.
Nope.
I was thinking that too, just the one word, no.
Yeah.
You don't even have to say, I'm in my doctorate or whatever, just,
I think you pretend that you don't know how babies are made.
I mean.
So I think that they go, no, when are you going to have kids?
Tell
God,
you.
I want to, I just
that's,
can't.
That's
they'll
the
tell
thing,
you.
Is Whitney kind of landed on something.
Could you explain it to me?
If you just say no, or if you really just dismiss it completely out of hand,
right,
that holds more water in these conversations than explaining reasons. Because if you explain reasons, then you're opening yourself up to a conversation.
Yeah, people feel the need to respond to your reasons.
Yes.
Yeah.
Also, I think I've...
That's with anything.
That's true.
Yeah, because I've learned this, again, like this is the second question in a row. I've kind of come back to this, but like being a supervisor at work, like... to not have to explain certain things.
Right.
Yeah. Like, this is what's happening. Decision's been made.
Yeah.
As opposed to, like, if you try to soften something up, like with, I used to talk about this all the time in rehab, like working with clients that are entering early recovery.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if someone says, like, hey, let's go out for a drink, let's go do whatever, to not, to just say, no, I don't drink anymore.
Right.
But don't not to say like, oh, I wish I could, but.
Yeah.
Because if you say, I wish I could, but all you've done is you've said, here's this obstacle. Help me overcome this obstacle.
Right. You
and then I'll go do this thing.
Would you go out with me? Oh, this couch is in the way. Oh, okay. So I should help you move this fucking couch. Like, not just no.
And I do think you do kind of open up that, like, if you go into like a backstory, then people are like, oh, well, I can help you with this.
Yeah.
Here, let me talk you how I didn't get my PhD, you know?
Yeah.
And like,
and writer's in an interesting situation, right? Because like, I feel like in all three of your cases, your answer is definitive. It's not soon. It's no. Whereas in writer's case, it's like, yes, these things will be happening.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I want to answer your question in full. And it puts you in a weird position because if you just say no, you're probably right. Like it could just be done. But in writer's case, it's like, yes, my plan is this. And then unfortunately, you're adding that information. I think you're all three correct. As soon as you do that, you're pointing at the couch, and they inherently walk over and start inspecting the couch.
Well, not only is it that, you are then inviting them to have conversation about it.
Yeah.
So if your issue, and part of writer's issue is, you know, this isn't people's business.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you invite them to have that conversation, you're kind of making it their business.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that part kind of comes back to you a little bit. Where you can just, there are ways to just shut down a conversation.
Right.
I mean, it could just be like, nope, we've never wanted kids.
Yeah.
Or
to be able to say like definitively, we are going to be having kids in exactly 5 years. I have a milk jug of frozen sperm.
Yeah.
It's in the garage.
Well, your
ready
sperm's going
to
go bad by then. What if your freezer
Not
breaks down?
Sperm.
You better hurry up and
this
get that sperm.
Never goes
I've
bad.
Got the creme de la creme of turkey basters ready to go.
Pew, pew.
Well, I pray to Satan every day. When he blesses us with a child, we're going to be very happy.
Yeah, that's the real answer.
Yeah.
Oh, be like, God. Whoa, we have a bigger problem. Actually, don't have
never
that.
Mind. Never mind.
No,
that is a tough one. People do feel, but I feel like, and this, you know, I'm sure that everybody listening to this has already thought this. I'm not, you know, saying anything interesting here, but it's true. This is, I feel there is a huge double standard here where women, it is socially acceptable for any fucking person, your coworker, anybody that barely knows you, to just comment on shit like this.
Or touch your belly.
Yeah, or fucking, just like, it's just, there's no fucking boundary where it's like, are you
going
to have a baby?
I'm not even pregnant and I have that problem.
Yeah.
People just touching my belly.
Can I just touch you? Like, what the fuck are you doing? But like, there's
because
no boundary
nice
here. And you know, like, it's tricky because like, I appreciate that in the world that women live in, there is a lot of conversation about a lot of this stuff, and it isn't verboten. Like, you know, like talking about relationships or like, how are you? And if like, you know, you're getting your hair done and your hairdresser's like, how is everything? And you're like, oh, you know, we're having a hard time. That is not weird to bring up.
Yeah.
You know, whereas if I just say that shit to my barber, it's like, fuck, like the temperature just dropped 10 degrees. Like neither of us was okay with me being so honest. I feel like women are more comfortable talking about that stuff. It's not weird to do it. But unfortunately, the side of that sword is like, and then people fucking feel like they have permission to ask.
Yeah, I do feel like some of the choices that I have made in my life up to this point, like other people who think more traditionally would not have agreed with. There's a lot of pushback when I finished grad school, and instead of jumping into maybe an internship, we went and like lived abroad, mm-hmm. and I just taught fourth grade for a year. And I remember, you know, people being like, "Oh, you're wasting your degree," or "You're doing that." Like, there will be feedback from people that care about you and think they're helping. And when you live in Midwest type of towns, everyone cares about you, right? You have a community. Yeah. You have townspeople, I think. Nick, you can comment more of that. Like, who just kind of know your business, so they feel they have a right to comment on your life. What a weird
town. Like, the mailman's like, "Nick, I really need to talk to you about your life choices." You know, I think.
No, the mailman is, I bet your mom, like, probably knows
fuck
her.
The mail
person. I think so. Your mom definitely knows that. Definitely. It's a mail woman, first of all.
Male person.
Male person.
Is it a male male person or
a female mailman?
It was a male person, but now it's a female, I believe. But honestly, oh my God, mom, that just reminded me of something.
I kind of
wish
you
would have, because here's the thing.
Somebody's got to carry that package.
Somebody
save
this.
So this just happened this past week.
I am
on the edge
box.
Of my seat right now.
All right. Sidebar.
Yeah,
fuck this question. Go on.
Okay, so I told you, I told you guys off air a couple weeks ago about the baseball card.
Yeah.
Okay? Oh, no.
So sent that in to get it graded.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And it's being sent back to the house.
Oh, my gosh.
Okay.
Real quick, TLDR for the audience. There is a special rookie Nolan Ryan baseball card in the family. And we've discovered this, and now there is a checking of its veracity to make sure it has value.
Yeah.
And then there's a question of who
the male person is in charge now,
is what I'm hearing. Yeah. And that now you're all caught up.
And I'm not going to get into any of that on here. But
I just did.
Thank you.
I was like, I feel like Nick would have shared that if he wanted to, but go on. Yeah.
So it got graded, being sent back. Okay. I get a call from FedEx.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
They're like, "Hey, yeah, we can't deliver this
too
because
valuable.
This address doesn't exist."
What the fuck?
Okay. The house number is right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The street number is right. And in my hometown, the house number, street number is followed by what quadrant of the town?
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
Northeast, southeast, southwest,
really?
Northwest. Okay.
What the hell?
There's weird addresses in the country.
It's supposed to go to northeast.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But they had it shipped to southwest.
And they couldn't figure it out.
Yeah. And I'm like, okay, my mom could open the door and just yell.
Yeah.
And say, "Hey, I'm over here.
Yeah.
Because the entire town is like four blocks.
Yeah.
Like, there's no reason.
They would see her name and know where to send that to.
Like, where is it?
She's like, "This is FedEx. We don't take those kind of leaps."
We're not risking
it. We're not in the business of making assumptions. So they ended up shipping it back. Oh, so anyway, they just
hope nobody is ever waiting for a fucking liver transplant.
Okay, I was getting nervous.
Where is the hospital? I'm like, facing north. Like,
and I
turn
get
around.
I get from their perspective, okay, that's probably the right thing to do.
I guess.
You don't just drop it off at the address that's the closest.
Yeah, that's probably,
you know,
fair, yeah.
But still, I was like, "Oh God, now." And then I had to call FedEx, and then FedEx is like, "Well, are you the shipper?" I was like,
kind of.
Yeah.
I was at one point.
Because if you're not the shipper, then you can't change the address.
Yeah.
Right. Yep, sure
so
I am.
I had to call the baseball card grading company and
Have them do it.
It's a fucking nightmare.
That's a mess.
Anyway.
Okay.
Sorry.
Small towns.
Yeah.
They know your business.
They know your business. And see, that's the thing. Like, if that was not FedEx, if that was just the local postman,
he wouldn't
need. My mom or my grandmother lived in a town that was half the size of the one I grew up in.
Yeah.
Okay. She was the postmaster general. Okay, I'm not kidding. She worked for the UPS. USPS.
This feels like that town with like the hotel.
People would
and they'd strange hats.
Literally,
like,
yeah.
I'm the judge, and now I'm the postmaster.
So people would literally
the mayor.
She would and she would get letters all the time that would just be addressed to grandma.
Okay.
And she would just look at where it came from, and she's like, "Oh, this is so-and-so's grandson."
No way.
And she could do that. Yeah, she could just do that.
Discretion.
You know? It's like.
That's fantastic. I love it.
But that's small town culture. Like, everybody knows your business. Everybody thinks that And they take it up like it's a challenge.
Yeah.
Like, oh, you're struggling with this. Oh, you don't understand. Here's how this works.
Yeah.
Like, oh, you think you have to finish your degree before you have kids. Oh, let me help you out. Let me set right. the record straight for you. No, you don't need to do it. See, aren't you glad I'm here?
Right.
I can steer you in the right direction.
Right.
And just the idea of like, oh, no, I'm going to wait until after.
And they're like,
that's just
oh, no.
such a foreign concept.
You shouldn't do that. Here's
yeah,
why.
Like, they like, well, why would you do that? I like it would not cross their mind.
You know, Whitney's point about region, I think, does matter. Because I do think that there's like a West Coast thing of like, I think that the dig on the West Coast is that it's hard to make friends.
Mm-hmm.
People are pretty detached. They're not necessarily like into your life. And I think that that would play to the advantage of the writer in this situation,
yeah.
right? Because if you told somebody like, oh, do y'all have kids? No, we probably will one day, though. Great. So sushi? Like, you know, that's the end. Like, nobody gives a fuck.
Well, yeah.
Like, that's the end of that conversation.
And if it's your neighbor, they're just like, okay, cool. Now that we got that out of the way, I need you to move your garbage
Move your
cans.
Fucking garbage can.
Yeah.
Nobody talks to their neighbors, except Whitney, for whatever fucking reason.
Yep.
Whitney's, like, trying to form boards with her fucking neighbors.
And it's working.
I talked to my neighbor today.
Did you
Aww,
really?
Oh, look at
my next door neighbor, Steve.
Like... Okay. How's All Steve right. doing?
Steve's good.
We don't talk about Steve enough.
No, we don't.
Is he happy?
He's good.
Did
Bring
you
him
ask?
On the show. Is he having kids?
He's had several.
Okay. Oh, all right.
Well, when's he going to start having
more?
I don't think he's going to have more.
You don't
want to
sleep on that, Steve. You got to keep going.
Yeah.
You know, you don't want to run out. Your seed is your responsibility to God.
Jeez. Yeah. I don't know. I have found that if you give just a no, or and whether that's true or not, if it's none of their business, mm-hmm. it doesn't really matter, does it? How true it is? Like, I don't mm-hmm. know.
Is
Unless
part,
it's your parent. Like,
right. Is
whatever.
That part of the politeness culture of that region, though, that you feel like you have to say more? That you can't just say no because then you seem mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can speak for myself, yes.
Yeah.
Like, it's... Yeah. You don't want to be perceived as rude.
Yeah.
Well,
so you don't want to just give a one word mm-hmm. answer because then you become, you're cold and standoffish.
Okay. So here's what I do. I don't know if it's right or wrong, but they don't tend to ask more even when I can see behind their eyes. They might want to or will say more. Whether you agree with this or not. Normally they're like, oh, are you and Peter going to have kids? I'm always like, no. And it's just kind of a plastered smile.
Okay.
And it's like trailing off to where you could be touching on a sensitive topic. You don't know.
And then they drop it.
And they look and they're like, you can tell they want
anyway.
To a little bit, but
yeah.
they don't.
Okay, I like
Like,
that.
I don't know. I know it's
it
a little
is.
Avoidy, yeah. but it's like, no.
Yeah.
It is kind of your way of.
I like that.
Like crying and running out of the room.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's you're kind of sending a message like, this is a really
Do
sticky
you go
subject.
Here?
Yeah.
I'm not going to make a scene, but if you push me any harder.
Mm-hmm.
I like that, Whitney.
I don't know.
I think that's a solid move.
It's been working, so I don't know. That's my advice from personal experience.
Do you have one of those for the house part?
I know, the house part.
How do we
Gosh,
do the house thing?
That one, I would just be more... I don't know. I don't want to say aggressive, but a little more assertive with that. And we're ready to move on. Or yeah, we want to live somewhere different. I mean,
right.
if you, it's kind of like talking about feelings. You can't argue with someone's feelings. It's like,
right.
I guess you can argue with someone's wants, but not really. It's just,
yeah.
oh, we want something different.
Well, also, like, I think that a lot of factors play into this kind of stuff because I feel like if like the writer is talking about how they're doing really well, they're into their
mm-hmm.
careers
mm-hmm.
and they don't really have other responsibilities right now. So they're, like they're building. Right.
Yeah.
And I feel like when you're in that mindset, it's like, okay, we're trying to get like the maximum amount of house we could afford.
Yeah.
Like we're trying to make some big moves
mm-hmm.
here.
Mm-hmm.
And that could be unsettling to people that know you. They're like, but y'all are just getting started. Like, you know, you just get like a sensible starter house, you know, or whatever. And it's like, hey, don't worry about my finances. Like we've
yeah.
got
yeah.
this.
Sometimes
but
I will agree with those people though. I did think
yeah.
about that. They're like, oh, well, your house is so great. Look at it. I'm like, I know it is.
Yeah. You just say that.
It is.
It
Our
is
house
so
is
great.
Great. And we're going to move.
The sex dungeon is not nearly big enough. That's
there's a whole show about sex dungeons.
There's so
Jim.
Many
Do
ways.
Do you want me to send that to you later?
So many ways to be passive aggressive with this too. Like,
yeah.
oh, this house is so wonderful. It would be wonderful for someone like you.
Ooh.
Now you might like it.
I think you would. I think
do
you would
want
do
it?
Well in this house.
What
this
are reviews on Indian burial grounds?
Yeah.
Do you enjoy the
pet cemetery?
Our house is haunted, so yeah. you tell me how great it is.
No, I do think though that like that's part of it. I think part of it is just that like especially if you happen to have resources that other people in the community do not.
Right. Yes.
And especially if you're younger, like older generations are going to be looking
they're
at this.
They're shocked
and like,
when young people can afford bigger or like more house,
what are you
whatever.
Doing?
And they're just, they're just like, oh no, this is a waste of money. You shouldn't be doing this. And it's hard. I think it's hard for people to see that. And so part of it may just be frustration or jealousy on their part as well.
Yeah. And, you know, I think the best available answer was Whitney's like trailing off, like find a way that sort of subtly implies
none of your fucking
ask
business
me this anymore.
Yeah.
But I really like that angle because like the anger angle doesn't sound like it would feel natural to the writer. Doesn't that feels like, hey, I know they mean no harm. I'm irritated, but I don't want to be that person. Mm-hmm. But I really like the other angle of making it like you're hurting me. Mm-hmm. Like, please don't ask more questions. This hurts me. I'd like to talk about something else. Because people are, they're already quite polite. They're interested in your life. Sure. They're intrusive. But if they sense that like, oh shit, I'm stepping on your feelings.
This
jumping back of like, no, I'm sorry. I don't want to hurt you. Are you, oh my God. And like, for the love of fucking God, America, don't ask women about pregnancy.
Jeez.
I cannot tell you how many people I have had who've been through a fucking miscarriage or some shit.
Yes. Yeah.
And then like they just randomly go meet new friends or they're like introduced to their parents' friends or whatever the fuck. And they're like, so when are you guys gonna be pregnant? And then like
tears.
Yep, she just fucking starts crying and leaves. Yeah. And everybody's like, oh my God, what did I say? And like, something that you just should have shut the fuck up about. Yeah. Like, just how
you
about
stuck
you
stuck your nose in somebody else's
spaghetti?
Business?
Yeah.
And there was a consequence for it.
If you're not prepared for handling that situation, you shouldn't ask that question.
Just don't.
It's like, it's almost kind of like jumping off of the high dive and then on your way down realizing like, oh, I don't know how to swim.
Yeah, maybe I shouldn't have done
like
that.
Maybe I shouldn't have done that.
You know, it's funny because as therapists, even the way we ask people is very roundabout. And need to ask because we're learning everything about them.
Yeah.
But if we talk to them and like we're sizing them up and we're making certain judgments, we know we're going to ask about their lifestyle and who's in their life and where they have children. But even the way we ask that tends to be very indirect and circular and leaves lots of room for you to like have ways out of that conversation or to drop a hint.
Yeah, and we can also handle that situation when it goes bad.
Right.
You know?
Say, like, we've been trying to have kids for 3 years. We've had 10, miscarriages. Like, okay, you're in the right
place.
You're
in
therapy.
We can deal with that. I think the other thing, too, like, I guess my approach would be a little bit different in Whitney's, and maybe this is just female versus a male perspective. Like, I would come at it very direct in the sense that, like, I think of the example that I can relate to, which would be like finish school versus having kids. Yeah, but like, you should have kids. No, I'm gonna finish my degree. Mm-hmm. Oh, there's plenty of time for that. Like my response to that would just be like, no, definitely not. I'm in it now. I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna get this done. Then I'll worry about that. So it's a lot more kind of
committing
direct,
to what
like,
you want.
Yeah, like. No, I think your idea is stupid. This is
well, it's kind of like addressing your needs rather than getting into defending like what they're saying. It's more like, oh no, the doctor is important to me. This is really important. Like, because then it shifts. Like, hey, remember you're asking about my life, not what you think is important, like having kids or I shouldn't sell my house or whatever. Like, it does center it back on you. Like, oh no, the doctor is important to me, and we love our life right now. It's been great.
Well, like, and coming back to like Southern or Midwestern sensibilities, the obvious move is just say, God told me to finish the doctor.
Oh,
first.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Like,
no one can argue that.
God told you? God told me to do that. Oh, well, fuck. Okay. It's kind of like Idiocracy. Like, the plants told me they want water from the toilet.
Yeah. Right. Rewatched that.
You
so
can
good.
Talk to plants.
I know.
Yep.
Well, they need water. Right. No, but they need electrolytes.
Yeah, I'm a Brondo. Okay. It's called Plants Grave. No,
plants
they told me they want water from the toilet.
Yeah.
Yeah. So just do that. Just
you can
say,
also go
God
with the old, if you want something that's like more aggressive than just passive aggressive, you can
aggressive,
go with
aggressive.
The, my mom asked me that question last week. Wasn't any of her business either.
Oh,
burn!
Yeah,
You can't survive in a small town that way, Jacob. Okay.
Well, I think if you're a woman and you're talking to a man and he says, "Oh, when are you gonna have a baby?" then you do the whole, are you offering?
Make him really uncomfortable.
Like, I mean, now?
Like, if it is a woman, you'd be like, your husband looks fertile.
Are you busy?
Yeah. Well, now that you mention it.
Yeah. Well, so when are you having kids?
You offering up your sperm count?
Yeah, what's your sperm count?
What are you batting right now?
Hey, what about that? Just
here's your average, man.
Yeah, the question's back on them. Like, what is your sperm count?
I don't know. What's your calendar look like?
Yeah.
That's the move. Again, we go back to the very first thing that we said, which is just just make it so much more uncomfortable.
I mean, I can understand why you'd ask that. I mean, seeing as how you're pregnant right now and everything.
You're not.
Oh, this is awkward now. Almost like we shouldn't have brought this topic up at all.
Oh, my gosh.
Let's both agree not to talk about
nosy
this.
Nosy bitch.
This is why God made you ugly.
Blake Lively totally got in hot water because there's an interview from years ago where she was pregnant with, I'm guessing one of her, I don't know how many kids she has, one of her children. And the interviewer says, congratulations on your little bump. And you can see her visceral reaction. She goes, congrats on your bump.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Fuck you.
It was awkward. Yeah, there's a whole like lore behind it that I won't go into. But it was interesting. I was like, oh, she pulled a Jacob.
Yeah. Also, yeah, it's just common sense. Never ask someone if they're pregnant.
Oh,
under no circumstances, unless the circumstance is like, I heard you were pregnant.
She did announce her pregnancy. That's why it was a little controversial. Like, she announced it. I'm pregnant.
Yeah,
and
somebody's.
Then,
you've given people permission.
It's still
to
weird for someone to be like, "Hey, I know you're getting fat."
Yeah, but that's what most people said. They're like, "You didn't say congrats on your pregnancy or your announcement." Yeah. It was like your little bump. It's like my body.
That's I do realize though that like how much a lot of this is like small town Midwest stuff because like. That's the thing is like I'm just kind of imagining my hometown where not only does everybody know everybody else, but we don't think of each other as other people in town. They're
right.
It's like their family.
You've known them their whole life.
You talk to them as though it's like, oh yeah, this is
Jim
this
Bob is, down the road.
Exactly. And so I mean, like I'll never forget when we went back home, Laura's first time back to Iowa.
First time ever to Iowa.
And she just
the incident.
She couldn't get over how when we go to somebody's house, you just knock the door and walk in.
You just walk in?
Yeah. Right. You just
that's
here
weird.
And you just walk in.
It's that's like what that I do. My neighbors, I'm like, the door's unlocked whenever you get. Yeah.
It's like that in Pahrump, like you know, where my in-laws live.
Oh,
and that freaks me the fuck out. Like their friends would just come over. Uh-huh. And they would just walk in. I'd be like, whoa, you know, like, hey.
Oh, I love
you know,
and
they're like, hi, how you doing? And I'm like, good, I guess. Like, but completely cut off.
You can't talk.
There's always an idiocracy. The cheese dip. Okay.
Really, all your answers are, it's all inside of idiocracy. Anyway, Ryder, it's a really relatable question. I think we're commiserating with you more than anything.
I don't think there's a real answer other than make people feel uncomfortable.
But I do think that there's something of value to instead of having to have an awkward conversation with the same person twice, having a move that ensures that one is done.
Yeah.
You will not be doing this again the next time you see them in a grocery store.
Ugly cry.
It's not revisited every time.
Having some kind of move that is either direct or like Whitney was demonstrating, like something that's kind of like an emotional whistle of like, please don't ask again kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Too sensitive. We're not that close. But I like the idea of trying on one of those awkward things and just biting that awkward bullet once each time. Because at least it'll be less to go around whenever you circle back around and see those people again.
Yeah.
Eventually run out of people you know.
Yeah. And I'm thinking, you know, my original goal by kind of trailing off with a no was not to purposefully make them think I have some super sensitivity to that question. My original goal was just, I was like, do I even want to get into this with them? Like while I'm going through the process, I was like, no, like drawing it out. But then I realized they just wouldn't ask if you just draw it out. Like I was like, nine times out of 10, they just drop it. We're just like, okay.
Yeah. I like that.
I don't know.
I still get asked those questions. people, but
more kids.
Yeah, I mean, which, you know, it's not.
When are you going to have kids of your own?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Speaking of that male person,
are you enjoying raising Jacob's children? I guess they're nice kids. They're sweet.
They know where the watershed is. Yeah,
Jacob talks. He's going to send child support eventually.
He's not going to raise them.
Somebody's got to do it. Yeah, no, but that comes up, you know. And I mean, my go-to phrase is just, I'm out of the baby business, you know. But mm-hmm. then I show them the vasectomy scar.
Yeah, that'll do it.
So anyway,
that sucks. Yeah. Like, you have the children and they're always asking one more until you hit like 3 and 4. I think then people are like, wait, you're having that
you
many?
You need to stop. Yeah, stop. You get into that Duggar level and people are like, you please don't have any more children. Yeah. So sorry, writer. There is no clean cut solution to this, but yeah, hopefully some tips there, and at least you know you're not alone. So hang out in the Discord, because I'm sure that there will be lots of comments.
Yeah, I
want
to hear
there.
Other people's I comments know. To this really bad.
That's where the tea is. We're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we're talking about the unexpected drawbacks of being a therapist. You're listening to Pod Therapy.
Today's episode is brought to you by Ben Dunn, Malia, Richard Macy, Sunny Boy, Thunder Cougar, Falcon Scoop, Slurpee Kaye Motherfucker, Sandra McWaffle, and Alina. And if you would like to sponsor the show like these wonderful people, go to patreon.com/therapy and sign up to become a Theraproducer. Okay, here we go. Pull up the right document. Blah, blah, blah,
blah, blah. Doing
here
great.
All right, here we go. What is the maximum number of golf clubs a player is allowed to carry in their bag during a tournament?
9.
10, 12, 14, or 16?
Jesus, those are all way more than I thought.
10, 12,
I know they have
14,
a driver,
a
putter, and then a wood, and an iron, so it's like 4.
That's all of them.
But then there's multiple numbers, so like I figure there's like 5 of those. So
right, I'm just thinking through my golf bag. Let me see. All right, I've got a driver.
That's one.
I've got 2 fairway woods. I've got a putter.
Yeah, 4.
So that's 4. Then I've got
the chip what are the
wedge. What are the wedges? I've got
there's more
a,
than one.
A sand wedge.
5. Yeah.
9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4.
Mm-hmm. So I was at like 12.
Now we're up to 11.
Head. Okay.
I think I have a 2 iron as well. I've got a real steep iron. So that's 12. What were the options?
Yeah, what are the options again? I need
10, 12, 14, 16.
Probably 14.
I'll say 16.
I was going to say 14.
Yeah, let me land on 14.
It is 14.
There
Whoa!
You go.
Dummy.
Got one right, finally.
I'm so good at golf.
You are.
Oh, thanks, Whitney.
All the people who've played, I've like played one full round my whole life.
It's one more than me.
It's so fun.
What is the highest proof bourbon can be distilled before it's considered something other than bourbon?
Oh.
100.
120.
160. Damn. 190. Or 200.
Oh, that's way off.
Before it's not bourbon anymore?
Yeah.
I thought bourbon was like the way it was prepared and flavored.
160.
Probably, at some point, it's probably fuel.
I'm going to say 160.
Yeah, I think 160.
All right. That feels right. I'm going there too.
We're all
160.
Yay. Woo! God, I'm so good at this game.
I don't know the math that you guys did. The math that I did was I thought through some of the higher proof bourbons that I have.
I feel like I've heard that somewhere before, but I
because I know I've got one that's like 150 something.
Yeah.
But I don't have any that are higher than that.
Yeah.
Okay. Last one. When recording a podcast, what is the typical recommended sampling rate to ensure high quality audio?
I have no
You are
idea.
Asking the wrong podcast.
Jacob literally
we don't give
just
a shit about quality audio.
One of us has multiple podcasts in here, so I'm going to look for that.
22, I'm guessing kilohertz, KHZ. What is that? 44.1 kilohertz.
Oh my God.
48. Or 96.
One time I was guesting on that Vegas news show. What's the thing called again?
Oh, the city one?
Yeah, Vegas the city. Show. Vegas.
CityCast.
CityCast. The CityCast Las Vegas. And one of the prep things the producer did with me is they were like, hey, if you're whatever you're using to record on your side, set it to that number.
What was the number?
I think it was a 20 something, but that feels like that was a bad one.
22. I'm going to guess 44.1.
I'm going to go 22.
The question is for the ideal. Listening, is that what it said? Ideal?
Typical recommended sampling.
Also, after this is done, I want Jacob to explain what the fuck this even is.
Go in the 22 one.
He can't even get any of the microphone questions right. You think
true.
You
yeah,
want
that's
his
right.
advice?
Yeah, that's true.
It's true.
What was he rain manning on the like recently?
Rain man.
Besides,
oh yeah, what was that?
It's not the not the therapy questions. It was like before that. Yeah. He just like every single one. I was like, oh my god.
Yeah, we just found his little.
Yeah, he's like, I got it. I don't know. I just knew that was the answer. I was like, okay.
Oh, I don't know.
I'm gonna come up with it later. All right, what's the answer, Jacob?
Oh,
the actual answer to the question.
My guess is they're gonna say 44-1.
Damn it. Mine was 22. Was my guess or the first one?
44-1.
Yeah.
Right on.
Interesting.
What was Jim's was 22?
Jim's, it was wrong. Whatever it was.
Whatever.
Yeah. Yeah. Safe assumption.
I was on the lower end of that.
Okay, you're up, Jim.
Oh, question?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The unexpected drawbacks of being a therapist. From Andrew Langmead, longtime supporter of the show. The other day I was thinking that therapists must wind up hearing movie spoilers all of the time. Mm. I was at a movie and parts of it gave a very nostalgic feeling. In the past 10 or 15 minutes of the film, or in the last 10 or 15 minutes of the film, a huge plot twist that was a huge emotional gut punch happened to me. I left the movie in tears. Once I reached the car, I was thinking about how I might describe the event to a therapist, but was thinking there was no way to explain it without spoiling the big plot twist. But also, I'm not going to talk about it because describing the event and the emotions behind it seems like it might be an important part of therapy. So I sort of left it thinking that as a one very, very minor trade-off in a career as a therapist is a slightly higher likelihood that your clients will spoil movies for you. Every career, in particular job choices, always have their advantages and disadvantages, and sometimes someone from the outside wouldn't think of one or more obscure ones. Are there any weird advantages or disadvantages to being a therapist that some not involved in that industry would never think of? Thanks,
that's a fun
guys,
question.
Andrew. That's a good one to end on. I like that.
Too much sex.
Dude, just yeah. So
with
much
your clients.
Sex. Oh, my God. It's women throwing panties at you all day.
That's why we got into podcasting.
That's yeah. Right. Yeah. To cool off all those ladies.
Cool off, yeah.
Not enough. Wearing a poncho everywhere.
Oh, wow, y'all really nailed it. So true.
It is so true.
Oh my gosh. Have you ever thought about this, Jim?
The movie spoiler thing is real.
Okay. I was thinking about this and I have not had that happen yet, surprisingly. I don't think. I've had clients talk about shows that were like obscure. And then I'm like, oh, I want to watch that now. So I might write it down.
Yeah.
But yeah, I had a client this week mention The Joker, but they didn't tell me what happened because that wasn't important. They're just like, oh, I went to the movies or whatever. But I don't hear a lot of, oh my gosh, this movie impacted me so much. And here is the spoiler.
I get those.
Well, here's what I do.
Yeah.
In that situation, I stop them and I say, here's what I want to focus on. I want you to focus on how you reacted to the movie. So tell me your feelings without going into detail.
Bruce Wayne was Batman? God damn it!
What's the icy dead people, Bruce Willis?
Oh, yeah. The Sixth Sense.
No. He was dead the whole time.
This does spoiler. Come up. The movie spoiler thing is for real. But I think there are other, like, you know, just random ass disadvantages. I mean, to like every career. Mm-hmm. One of them for me is the fear that I will bump into people in the wild.
Mm-hmm. I do.
And that's
sometimes.
Happened. I've gone to get my hair cut, and it turns out the one available person was a patient.
Someone just told me today, this morning at brunch, I was at my brunch book club with other therapists, and one of the girls there was like, oh, this client I'd met with. Her son and my friend met with the mom or whatever, but she was like buying a washing machine or something like her dishwasher. And she was like, it wasn't until I was checking out and I'd like seen her name. I was like, oh my gosh, I totally worked with this.
Oh
person.
Yeah. No. And that actually is, it's funny because like it can just happen and you just kind of go, okay, well, whatever. It's not a big of a deal. But like there's especially in Vegas, part of the fun of living in Las Vegas is the world-class entertainment that you have and all these shows and all these wonderful things. But then these are real industries, these are real people. They go have healthcare providers.
Yeah.
And then if you end up working with them from that moment on, for many of us, that show is off. Like I can't see a lot of things and I'm like, okay, well that's, I can't do that anymore. Like it's just not available. And so it's just really tough. Like I can't go to any strip club in Vegas,
Oh,
you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, what about me?
What does that have to do with therapy, though? That's just because your wife told you not to.
No. It's because of the
it's because you've been banned
from
this.
Yeah, it's because of all the legal orders.
That wasn't because of therapy.
Yeah, it really doesn't have anything to do with patients. Just
Jim's a little handsy.
Yeah. I've been bounced at this point. But I think that's a real disadvantage where I don't think any other profession has that. Like if you're a dentist or a cardiologist, mm-hmm. you're not like, oh, I can't go see this show because I have a patient there. In fact, you probably got comped tickets to that show and you don't give a fuck.
Yeah.
You could go see the show.
Yeah. Yeah, I could.
The show one is a little... That feels like a stretch on your end.
That's
yeah.
more...
It's case that's, by case. It's I case by case. But like, it's showing up to their workplace... And I have to be mindful of that. So, like, it does make me eerie. Now, you all know I'm not a guy who wants to go see a bunch of shit anyway. I'm happy sitting at home playing video games.
It's a perfect.
So, like, I'm just saying it is a disadvantage.
I also can't leave Nevada.
It's so weird.
This is just an excuse on Jim's part.
Yeah. Oh, I can't.
Yeah. Movie spoilers is a thing. No. I think just spoilers in general, like for books, like there's just so many things.
This might sound bad. I don't care about spoilers so much. Half the time, I just forget what they've said about
that
book or movie. Like,
well,
because
you're
real
not
life.
Listening to them anyway.
Yeah. Why would
you get
I?
Get your earbuds in the whole time.
I know. I was doodling.
I'm sorry. Who are you?
No, I will literally watch movies. And if some years pass, I'll be like, oh, I forgot how this ends or like what happens here. Like I forget a lot of the movie. I don't know if what that says about me in general, but movies or things like that. I experience it. This is my opinion. I experience it when it's happening. And then I'm just like, all right, it doesn't stick with me. So when someone tells me a spoiler, unless it's something really intense or very specific, I don't know. I'm just like, okay, I'll listen and just be there listening.
Yeah.
And then I don't think about it again.
That's fair. Yeah, I know a lot of people like that. And I think it's a gift. Like,
I'm thankful for it, to be honest. Yeah.
Like, the other day, I was talking to my wife, and I was like, my daughter had asked us a question about, like, Abraham Lincoln. And so my wife was like, oh, she asked this really cute question the other day. And so she's just telling me a story about her little girl. I'm like, oh, that's really funny. And then I was like, oh, yeah, you know, do you remember that scene in Lincoln, the movie?
Mm-hmm.
And she's like, oh, no, I've always wanted to see that movie. I was like, you have seen it twice.
Okay,
me.
I'm not that bad. Well,
like,
I don't think I have.
How do you not
know.
Fucking remember? And she's like, no, we've seen this movie. I was like, that's what you said the second time I made you watch it. And you're like, oh, I really want to see that movie. I'm like, you've seen it once.
We're going to talk about that after. I have some thoughts about that.
And it's always really funny because like at the end of these movies, that's when she'll be like, oh, yeah, now I remember. Like, oh, when the fucking credits roll, that's whenever you suddenly click.
That
and then
name.
You're like, oh, yeah, this part.
This is the least dramatic thing about Jim that his daughter has blocked in her mind.
Yeah. That's right.
Daniel
no,
Day
but
Lewis.
Like another disadvantage, I was just thinking about this the other day because, it was today actually. I was at the store doing some grocery shopping as I was getting ready for my great grill extravaganza, which mm-hmm. went splendid. But I got conversational with this guy in one of the aisles. We both had our Raider stuff on. And so he's like chatting with me about it, whatever. We're getting along. And, you know, he's just being really nice. Just really friendly. And I found myself struggling a little bit. Like, and I don't know that this is a universal thing, but I think there's a percentage of this that any therapist could somewhat relate to, but I'm sure a large portion is Jim just being a neurotic mess. But like,
usually
that's it. But like, there was a part of me that's like, sometimes it's hard to interact with somebody and do that in my most natural way
mm-hmm.
that is not.
Therapish.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so like, I don't, it's tricky because it's not like these skills become part of how you just talk to people.
Yeah.
But then like in my mind, I'm like, no, Jim, don't use those. Uh-huh. Don't do that. Mm-hmm. Just be you. But then I'm like, who am I? Like, I don't know how to be me in a objectively friendly way. There's a handful of people in my life I do that with. And pretty much it's you three. Like, I don't really have anybody else. I just can just go to a bar with completely be myself. And it's a very strange reality that I've associated with the career that I sometimes have a hard time like knowing how to fully not have any of that present. But then I think like, well, maybe that's not a good thing. Like maybe these are nice skills that I should use in my friendships. But then I worry that my friendships aren't real because then I'm like, if this guy really likes me and we're getting along and he wants to be friends, does he really want to be friends with me or did I therapy his ass and I did the joining thing,
mm-hmm.
which is great as a skill if you're trying to save somebody's life or change their life. That's a really gifted therapist, but hard to know if you're authentically forming true friendships when you have that ability. Does that make sense?
It does. It does. I just spoke with someone else about something similar
yeah.
recently where I had to outright tell them you're valued not because you ask questions, because you're a therapist. They were actually not a therapist, but yeah. like they were doing the same skills. And mm-hmm. To some extent, it almost gets like kind of annoying. I'm like, just be you. Like right. I can tell you're not being you. Like yeah. just be your authentic self and we'll care about you and love you anyway.
Yeah.
But it's hard when you've built a relationship from that to test those waters and be like, yeah. okay, if I'm not Mr. Therapy or talking to you in a certain way or style or tone, are you still going to appreciate me and value me and be my friend?
Yeah.
That's hard.
Yeah.
I don't know if I've ever had that issue.
Yeah.
I don't really either, but.
Yeah. Because I think for me, I never looked at it as like, you know, the things that you learn as far as skills that you can bring into therapy. I've never looked at it as like, this will make me a better therapist. I've looked at it as like, this will make me better at having a conversation.
Mm. Right.
And then having a conversation makes me a better therapist.
Yeah.
Also makes me just a better conversationalist.
Yeah, it right. does.
You know, so
yeah.
I don't feel like I have to separate the two if I'm not doing therapy, because it's not therapy. It's just I'm genuinely interested. So I feel like it's changed the way that I talk to people, but I still don't feel like I'm therapizing or anything.
Right.
I don't have that distinction anymore, because it both of them feel genuine.
Yeah.
Like if I felt like I was being disingenuous and I was implementing mm-hmm. some sort of CBT or solution focused yeah. or something like that, if I felt like that, then yes, I feel like that would be, to me it's just about being genuine versus not genuine.
Yeah.
So I
do feel like I do. I'm gonna come back. Yeah, I tend to not, but I do sometimes. And sometimes with friends, I'll even kind of preface it or ask them, like, if they go into something that's they're really struggling with, I'll kind of start prefacing it like, hey, I do have some feedback. It's kind of like therapy feedback. Like,
right.
You know what I mean? Like, okay? Hey, I'm about to kind of yeah. ask you, because that's the best way I know how to handle this.
Right.
And so I sort of either get consent or like warning. Hey, this is not so much friend Whitney. Like, that's just going to be like, yeah, fuck
yeah.
them or whatever. Like,
I think for me, it's part of the problem. And this is, again, probably just gym neurotic stuff, not
probably.
So much the profession. But the bulk, like when I think about the amount of human contact.
I'm just agreeing. I'm supporting.
He's supporting me.
Like
thank
Jacob,
you, Jacob.
Right. Yep.
He just agrees.
Yep. Uh-huh.
Let me know I'm mm-hmm. right.
I'm just supporting mm-hmm. Jim's view
thanks,
on this.
Buddy. If you add up all the hours of interaction with other humans I've had in a month, it is so overwhelmingly therapeutic. Like if it's with students, if it's with patients, mm-hmm. if it's here on this show.
Yeah.
Like that tone is coming out so much that there's only a few interactions I'm having with family or off air with you guys that like isn't.
Yeah.
And so it becomes this other part of me that I lose touch with. And like I have trouble remembering what that guy sounds like.
Yeah. That's true.
It's
yeah.
a weird thing.
Yeah. You reminded me of something I hadn't realized till recently is I have an effect that happens that's not exactly what you just shared, but similar, where I love calling my friends and catching up and hearing about their lives and sharing my life. Like, mm-hmm. I have a lot of long distance friends. Maybe like Nick, you said you have friends that live like in a mm-hmm. bunch of other states. So for me, I really value that reconnection time. It might only happen every couple of weeks, but I'll spend mm-hmm. like 2 hours on the phone with a friend that I haven't talked to in like 2 or 3 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
But what I realized is once I really like got into private practice some years ago is my I don't know, like fuel tank or whatever mm-hmm. to be able to do that with my friends greatly mm-hmm. diminished. Like my time off now is I kind of want to just do my own thing. I want to like watch
yeah.
my show. I want to read my book. Uh-huh. I want to get in my pool or like,
right.
you know, I just take a nap. I don't know. Like my off time, I have much less of a desire to connect with my friends, which makes me sad.
Yeah.
So I feel like that is a negative that I've kind of taken away from being
yeah.
a therapist is like, I love to do that, but the juice is used. Like,
right.
it's
yeah.
all, or the
all
gas
my
is
connection
used,
muscle
like,
has been
mm-hmm.
fully flexed.
Mm-hmm.
Like now
I
it's
have
time to rest
no
that
desire
muscle.
To reconnect with my friends for a while. So that has gone longer or been shorter when I do talk with them. So that is a weird experience. And
mm-hmm.
yeah, when you feel like your value in your friendships a lot of time has been
yeah.
that therapy muscle, like you said, Jim, it's like, oh, are we okay? We're good, right?
Right.
Like
yeah.
I haven't called in caught up.
But. It's a, there's definitely some of those disadvantages. I mean, obviously, there's so many advantages, you know, to being in the profession as well.
Oh,
I
totally.
Mean, getting to meet so many diverse people.
That's the double-edged sword, cool. though, because then you can't tell anyone about all the cool people. I mean, you can, like, give some vague, like, oh.
I just love having, like, this firsthand window into so unique lives.
Yes.
And so, like, I'll be watching
or
a documentary.
Occupations.
Yeah,
or
and they'll
like,
be like, oh, this happened. And, like, I know what they're talking about. I'm like, oh my God, that wouldn't work this way. They would have mm-hmm. to do this. And it's like, how the fuck do you know that? And it's mm-hmm. like, well, I've had somebody that I've worked with and I know their intimate truth. And like, yeah, that's what they've told me life is like. And
yeah.
okay. And just, that's really cool to feel like, wow, you know, so many cool. interesting things and different people. That's really neat.
I do feel like the occupation thing is real. I, mm-hmm. I mean, yeah, I've learned about like factories
yeah.
and like, I don't know, banking,
right.
like all these weird
Even
things
just
that
stuff
are like,
that you think you know about yeah. and then you meet somebody who really does it. Mm-hmm. And they're like, what is being a mailman? And like, they're
yeah.
telling you about the real thing. You're like, oh wow.
I never thought twice about that.
I never would have thought, like I was talking to a guy the other day. He's telling me about delivering for a UPS mm-hmm. version of a company
mm-hmm.
and he wasn't union
mm-hmm.
and he's explaining he gets paid per stop and it's pennies per stop and like what that is like and how the metal in the vehicle is too hot to touch.
Oh my gosh.
Because it's all shined. And so you can't make skin contact and you also can't wear long sleeves because the vehicle won't shut. There's no air conditioning because
oh
you have
gosh.
To hop in and out every
yeah.
single stop. And just explaining that to me, it's like I would have never...
No.
thought about
Mm-mm.
that and he's just telling me I'm like wow like
yeah.
that and he's like bro you don't know what life is like until you've done 10 hours doing that
I do not much respect
wow you know
much
yeah.
respect
that's one of the cooler things
yeah
so.
I think one of the downsides is for me and this has been years like I haven't done clinical work in like 6 years but it was always concern or fear of running into somebody
right
out in public mm, it's mm-hmm. just an awkward situation I just don't want it to happen
mm.
or like if I'm yelling at somebody while they're cutting me off in traffic and then I'm like and then you follow that person into the parking lot because you're going to work or whatever and it's like
yeah.
oh this shit that sucks
so that happened to me
no
so this was a while ago so I can talk about it
maybe this is where I got it. I think you've told me this.
So I was on a summer vacation. It was this last summer. And I had a patient who lived in Vegas and they moved to California. And so I still talk to them and keep in touch with them in California. So I'm traveling through California and this patient knew, like I had seen them the week before and I was like, oh, I'm going to be in your town. You know, I'm really excited to go visit. I'm like, oh, and they give me recommendations. Like, oh, you know, if you get a chance, this is a great restaurant, blah, blah, blah. Like, great. And so, you know, but this is a major U.S. city. And so like, great, bye. And then I'm driving through this place, and then the next session I see that he goes, dude, I totally saw you.
Oh.
And I was like, are you sure? He goes, is your car this? Is this your plate? I'm like, yeah.
Is this your plate?
Yeah, he knew the plate because he saw the Vegas plate, you know,
oh,
but then he's
okay.
like, you know, I noticed the plate, so I wanted to ask if that was you, and so I memorized it. Mm. And so, like, you know.
And I
like,
called
yeah,
a friend at the police department.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
He ran
yeah.
him.
Yeah.
But I was
I
like,
know
you're
more
fucking
about
kidding
address.
Me. I was, like, on a freeway in California. And
wow.
you saw me. I was like, I hope I didn't do anything stupid. Like, I was just with my family on vacation. But I was like, no, man, I mean, obviously, I just saw you. Like, that's it. So
that's so funny.
But, yeah, no, that is so fucking random. Mm. Like, that can totally happen. Yeah, which doesn't scare me. I don't think it's that bad. Like, it happens. For me, my biggest fear is that I will do something wrong.
I'll mismanage
the
situation.
I just
yeah.
don't want them to feel bad that I've shown up and or, like, I've invaded their space.
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, that's my biggest thing. It's like, oh, shit, I forgot you do work at this restaurant. I didn't know it was this one. You know, but then are they going to feel like, wow, you didn't listen well enough to me, Jim, to know that this is the one I work at.
Mm-hmm.
And I mentioned to you the other day that I work on weekends and you fucking still can't. And like,
I know.
Oh, no. You know,
it's like a lot for us to remember, but I do
right.
feel bad when I forget yeah. something or I feel like I should have known.
And like, you know, I'm obviously overthinking mm-hmm. it. Like, most people don't give a fuck. Like, yeah. if they see us in the wild, they're just like, hi.
Yeah.
Like, which has happened to me too. Like, where I've shown yeah. them, like, hey, everybody, this is my therapist, Jim.
Oh,
like,
my God. Like,
I'm not legally allowed to do that, but I guess you can. Like, I can't do that. So,
well, anyway. They can.
Yeah, they do whatever
yeah,
they want.
They
yeah.
can.
Their truth. But anyway.
No,
so
lots
that
of
movie
cool
spoilers.
Stories, cool,
yeah.
cool lives. The movie spoilers, I don't care about that. But
I think it would be really hard to be a single therapist and be on like Tinder. And that kind of
I
th- shit.
Okay, I
I'll
do think about
hard.
This. I had a client did like once who was in healthcare and they were like, I cannot go on
yeah.
they're trying to make friends, but like I
okay.
can't even go on there because I'm probably going to run into these people, this population I work with. And I was like, shit, you will. I was like, I don't know. How do you make friends then?
I would imagine that is so.
Did I ever tell you about that?
Oh, no. Nick's been on the dating
apps. About how he met Laura?
Yeah. No. But yeah, I have come across on dating apps, not clients, but other people in the field.
Okay.
You know, but then there's one time I was, this is probably 4 or 5 years ago, with a friend, and we're at a bar listening to a band or whatever, and I'm sitting there just minding my own business at the bar. Bartender comes up and gives me a drink, says, the young lady over there bought you a drink.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, oh, that's very good. That's never happened to me before.
Yeah.
Like,
this is a big deal.
Big deal.
It was really cool. And, but I was dating Laura.
Uh-huh.
At the time, I think we've been together for a couple of years.
So you poured the drink out?
No.
Threw it in her face.
Threw it in her face. So, get away.
So I did.
Stranger.
I'm not allowed to talk to you.
I'm in love. What we have is real.
I'm in love. I don't care. You know,
I just ran out.
So I was nice about it. So I went over and I introduced myself. I said, hey, thank you for the drink. I appreciate this. I said, I actually have a girlfriend, but I do. That's very nice. And she's like, yeah, she's like, I saw you over there. And I just, you know, my friends kind of put me up to it. I was like, oh, that's very nice. And so just kind of struck up a conversation.
Yeah.
And, you know, talking about work or whatever. And she's like, oh, I do grant writing or whatever. I just work for this nonprofit thing or whatever.
Uh-huh. Like, go on.
And I was like, oh, really? What's the nonprofit? And she said what it was.
Uh-huh.
And it's a program that I
oversee.
Yeah.
And now you've taken a bribe.
Yeah. So,
oopsie.
Yeah. So that was
that's part of her plan the whole time.
That was what she was really up to. Yeah. Now you see that's called the honeypot, Nick. You're supposed to be smarter than that. Fool. And you go audit those files and she's like, it'd be a real shame if anybody found out about that time.
Oh, yeah, the dating app thing would be a big negative. Oh, that is interesting.
Can you imagine? That would be so hard. So like if you ever go onto the subreddit for therapists, that comes up all the time. Like you'll see people on there like, I saw my therapist on a dating app, and like, you know, they have all sorts of reactions to it, right? Like sometimes the predictable one of like, do I shoot my shot? You know, like, I mean, like, they're there. I'm here. We're clearly both available. Like,
oh my God, that's hilarious.
Do I just shoot my shot? Like, what are the rules? So that comes up. Or things like, I don't feel comfortable with this. Like, you know.
I know too much.
Yeah, or like, whatever, you know. Mm. Or they have a friend that dated that person.
Mm.
But like, they're not, we've never connected those dots. But mm-hmm. then they listen to friend tell a story about guy they went on a date with or whatever. And it turns out, holy shit, that's my therapist. And now they're like, it's weird. You know, so I could just see. It is a very different reality than any other healthcare profession where it's just very normal to like.
Yeah, if you see your dentist on there,
nobody gives
deal.
A shit.
Yeah.
No.
They just go out and do whatever, you know, just, I don't know.
It's very odd.
I scream loudly, ugly cry, and run from the room if I see my dentist in public.
That's
I thought
fair.
You were going to say if you saw your therapist in public. I was like, they'd chase you down. Wait, let's talk about it.
Yeah, the dentist does not chase you down.
No.
They let you go. That's the one that got away. Anyway, good questions here today. As we wrap up the show, I want to remind you can sign up patreon.com/therapy and get the extended show ad-free a day earlier, as well as enjoy our live chat Discord community and our weekly deep dives, interviews, skill shares, research roundups, and rants. And we've got we've got one very important new person.
Well, as we're talking about deep dives and whatnot.
Yes.
If any message from intern Emma,
yes.
If any of you have some ideas for some deep dives that you would want Jim or Emma to cover,
yes,
reach out through Discord.
Yep, we have a channel called Suggestion Box.
Yes, and there is, I'm sure Emma sent you the link. To
the outline is great.
Yeah, so we've got some stuff coming. Yeah.
Intern Emma, who is a licensed therapist, is developing awesome content. Like just the writing on this is so cool. Really cool deep dives into all sorts of stuff that people ask about all the time. It's going to become a library resource. I'm really excited for it.
Yeah. So if you have any ideas, reach out to her.
Emma's also threatening to do interviews with all of us and create a series where it's get to know a host. And
good just fucking luck.
Takes questions. Yeah. I think Emma's just in front of Jacob's house, just holding a mic. This is happening.
I heard things. Shit.
Good fucking luck.
I feel like, don't listen to him, Emma. He would do it. He'd be flattered.
Good fucking luck.
Anyway.
What are the odds that you're going to have a deep dive posted for the next
unlikely.
2 hours?
Very okay. unlikely.
Then just go ahead and move one of the...
From your stash yes. that you've got until next year? Yeah.
Yeah. I'm Thank through you. February already.
God damn you.
I'm done through February.
Wow.
But here's the thing. Just move one. Don't move all of them because some of them are time sensitive.
All
so.
Right. I'll only right. move one. Thank you. You're very generous. Speaking of generous, we want to thank all of our Therapods and supporters at patreon.com/therapy because it's the first show of the month. So we want to thank our Therapods, Sam Cohn, University Jeff, Robert Paulson, Polygon, Colin, Richard Bruin, Scoopstronaut, Corey Owens, Joseph Pengrazio, Christine Phillips, Gavin Bristow, Carrie Terhark, Stacey Westerlin, Kiwi Fruit Scoop, Take It EV Podcast, James K, Craig Little, Don Dore, Jim Hunter, Scoopatron, Todd Canfield, Felicia Butler, David Sorensen, Shayla Bullock, Lauren Izzo, Stacey Coleman, Adam Petanuzzo, Mats Lenegren, Scoopiter Ascending, Ian Soto, Jessica Cyphers, Lee Popsicle, That Josh Guy, Dr. Scoop Little, Mama Ninja Scoop, James Dawson, Sarah Olo, Grumpy, Lake Mead, Park Ranger, Sam Buck, Karen McCulloch, What Weekend, Some Nobody, Lila, Be Gay, Do Crimes, Kelly Gagner, Nippy, Brian Emra, Matthew Johnson, Alec Lancaster, J.D. Congan, A Literal Pickle, Matthias Vandebrandt, James Hubbell, Andreas Saavedra Molina, Max the Ginger Scoop, Ken Tinsley, Chemist, Julius Kappel, Stacy, Protect and Scoop, Smells Funny, Matthew Kubik, Chad the Safety Lad, Walker Fluke, Philip Guyton, Tim Mystery, Almost Dr. Nurse Joy, Duffy the Slowly Getting There Therapist Bear, Joel McMillan, Christopher DeGersey, Kierke Grimm, Trisha Ortiz, Chris Conway, Melissa Geisler, Kirsten Johnson, DJ Seward, Mississippi Hippie, Tiny Home Travelin', Scott A, Patty Glad, Fifi Eli, Freya Lawson, Heather W, Kyle, Todd V, Anthony Camerata, David Williams, Kate Police, Buddy Dobbins, Eric Dyer, Trontastic, Glitch Scoop, Aletta Balais, Bugnuts, Stephen Landon, Shai Ruparel, Adam Balaz, Robert Cole, Kenneth Wong, John Finlayson, Mysterious Annelid, KJ, Mr. Poth, Carmen Perry, K, Pizzle Dizzle, Temporary Reality, Jeff Darnell, Jamibi, Jacob Hurt, Syncytium, Persephone Hazard, Ray J. Shark, Recreated, Jacob Billingsley, Silka Daniels, Nathan Mookie, Jenny Rose, J.W. Reynolds, What Does Scoop Mean? A Crusty Croissant, Alex Jardine, Juan Monterey, Dylan Colopy, Wolfie 05, Nora Monaco, Autry Johnson, Ben Sherman, Chris Courtney, Dale the King, Cedar Hayden, Adam Goff, Jesse Miller, Livy, Terrible Tay, Acrylic Curve, Linus Hikason.
I was waiting for that
Fuck
one.
You, Linus.
Hikason.
Oh, yeah. Hakansa. Itty bitty chicken farmer.
And since Whitney is going to Italy on Saturday, she's going to read the following names in Italian.
Do it.
That's
a blue scoop.
Just read it now. Just do this with your hands.
Just yeah, keep doing pinch things with your hands and then insert a book at the beppo.
As a blue scoop, Brian Neyman, Scoop Brady, Fred Bashara Jr., Andrea Anderson, Scoop Lindsay.
For the record, she's doing the hand.
I'm doing the hand thing.
This is the only way that my voice is going to do this. Frozen Custer, Lori Elmstroth, Robert Ward, Linda Brandemeyer, Shonagan, Scoopy Scoopy Just Just, Okie Scoop, Dank Bottle, Darganati,
Margarine,
Brooks Lyle, Adam Rubich,
I'm taking a picture of her doing this.
Lovely Spark, Mr. V, Jim and Manu, Adam Warren, Manuel Cavazos. Wow, I feel like that turned into a different accent.
Little Eastern European.
I got very, so very Russian by the end.
with the hand pinch.
Yeah, that was the problem.
Yeah, I went very Russian.
Yeah, that was the big issue.
Yeah. Oh my god.
That was the problem, not my hand.
That is so funny.
I need to practice that more.
Oh, that was solid.
Clearly.
Sorry, I lost track of this script.
We've got a new Thera partner.
What? Thera partner?
Jake Schneider.
Thera partner.
About goddamn time, Jake Schneider. Special thanks to Jake Schneider, one of our original Thera producers, has always really set the standard and has just relentlessly supported us against all good judgment.
It's very confusing. Mm-hmm.
Very sad.
But we appreciate it.
To cry for help, really.
He's better to us than we deserve.
Oh, my God.
Grazie.
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 Jake Schneider. Schneider.
Wow, for someone who's never been to Italy, I'm impressed, Jim.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, I don't get enough credit.
You speak the first best Italian.
Well, I speak the first best Italian.
He has been to the Palazzo.
Yeah, so that's right. I've also been to Italy. This doesn't get brought up a lot.
What? I don't believe that. That's a lie. Bold-faced lie.
I went in high school.
Lies. Yeah.
I went to Rome.
Against his will.
Yeah, I didn't fucking want to go.
Yeah.
Is that the last time you ever went somewhere?
Yes. I went to Greece, the Mediterranean Isles, and Italy on a month-long high school trip.
Oh, my. Yeah. This is the whole thing.
This is why I'm over this shit. You know, it's like, oh, it's like,
because
so
he did
great.
It once.
Yeah, it's fucking dumb.
Jim should have been born in 1925.
Yeah.
Go on.
It's dumb. They ship you to Italy, make you go to war. Mm-hmm. Just not cool. Who else am I supposed to thank? Oh, Thera producers. Oh, Thera partners. So we'd like to thank the benevolent, revered, generous, and flagrantly pro-therapy diehards who love you all so much they give till it hurts. The Thera partners. A Dirty B, a Pickett,
yes.
A Jake, a Schneider.
Get it.
Get it.
Get it.
Get in there with that accent. Uh-huh. A Buca de Beppo. And we want to especially thank our bosses, the mysterious and shrouded Illuminati members of our fan club, the Thera producers. Thank you, Myra, Robert Brownie Jr., Mint, Smitty Scoop, Ben Don, Judy Schneider, Kayla Lansbury, Malia, Leon Kassab, Mason Miller, Richard fucking Macy, there it is, Carolyn Albert, Kevin Chamberlain, Tess Miller, Sammy Scoop, Ben Stanley, slap in your face, Sarah Smith, Adam Hathaway, Byler T, Mike Helm, Paris, Darren Cunningham, Lib, Team Monaco, Thunder Cougar, Falcon Scoop, Matt and Lisa Tangeman, Heyo, Oscar Swanrose, A Sunny Boy, Slurpee Kai, Motherfucker, Sandra McWaffle, Dan Martin, Hannah Marie, Andrew Langmead, Emma Kane, Alina, Cody, the DeLorean guy.
If you would like to hear this episode uncut and unedited,
and why you wouldn't you?
And why you wouldn't you?
We broke Jacob.
We did.
And enjoy our spontaneous side projects. Go to patreon.com/therapy and thank you for supporting mental health.
That's all the time we got for this week's session. We want to thank our landlords, Matt Mattingly's Ice Cream Social Podcast, and thanks to those of you who contributed to our show today. We really appreciate it. Remember, pot therapy isn't something to keep all to yourself. Share the episode with the world. Tag us on the socials when you do. It's at PodTherapyGuys on Instagram, Threads, and Twitter. It's /PodTherapy on Facebook. And don't forget about all the extra goodies at patreon.com/therapy.
Do you want to submit a question to the show? You can ask anonymously at podtherapy.net or email us at podtherapyguys@gmail.com. I'm Nick Tangeman.
I'm Whitney.
I'm Jim.
Thanks, and we'll see you for your appointment next week.
I speak the first most Italian.
You speak the second best Italian.
Oh my God.
That movie's
God.
So good.
That is such a good movie, man.